digital evidence processing, and how the forensic people can face these challenges and how they can achieve this task. Today, the topic will be presented by the great personality, the most experienced person, Mr. Yogendra Yadav, is the director of Lab Systems Mumbai. Mr. Yogendra Yadav has done Bachelor's of Engineering from Mumbai University. He has undergone computer forensic training at IDRBT by Government Examiner of Persistent Documents and Directorate of Forensic Science. Undergone training on NCASE Forensic and Enterprise Edition in Dubai. Trained on cyber law from Asian School of Cyber Law. Training on advanced vulnerability analysis and testing organized by Lab System. Mr. Yogendra Yadav is having a CES, CHFI, ISO certification and also MCSC, CCNA, A+, Red Hat, Linux and the Solaris certification. So tremendous experience with a lot of titles. As I told you earlier, he is heading as a director of Lab Systems India Private Limited in Mumbai. So let me give you a brief note about Lab System. Lab System is pioneering in digital forensic in India. They are a team of engineering professionals committed to provide digital forensic solutions to clients of different industries. It is one of the top distributors of world-class computer forensic software tools like NCASE, MyFRT, FastBlock, MiniDrawing, and Minimo. They also provide consultancy services and they assist in investigations and for recovering data. I think and this is the best opportunity to open up your mind and get into the details of this area. So I welcome Mr. Yogendra Yadav for this session. Over to Yogendra. Thank you.
So just about myself, having 16 years experience in the field of cyber forensics. Our expertise is only in cyber forensics and mobile forensics, that is the digital forensics, what we say. As a forensic expert, when we started our career for the past 16 years, we faced so many challenges in the technology, and that new challenges, the technology comes up, and again, there will be new challenges. When we started the cyber for imaging a particular hard disk, it used to take us 80 GB hard disk. And we used to say that, okay, if it is a So technology has come up a long way in this objective. What I want to share with you, what is the evidence? Yes. What is... Hello, am I audible?
You are audible, but someone is on unmute.
Hello.
Participants, I request, please do mute your audio.
Hello.
While the session is on, please don't interrupt the speaker. Please do switch off your audio as well as video.
Yeah.
Yes, sir, you can go ahead.
Now, in this object,
No, I think
Hello.
That's an internet problem.
Yes, I guess he has some internet issues. I'll try to connect my presentation otherwise. Just a moment.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Is it visible? Is the presentation visible?
No,
Denuga,
it's on.
Not yet,
Denuga.
Yeah, it's coming.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the main objective of this lecture was to find out what is digital evidence, what is digital forensics. This is how we are going to take the flow of the whole lecture. SOP of imaging, acquisition, seizure of digital data. What are the do's and don'ts while seizing of digital media, that is the digital evidence that we collect from a client location or the read location for us? What are the steps that we follow, and where exactly can we use automation in processing of evidence? And what is our current need of the hour, which is remote remote acquisitions, and our tool that we have developed at our company, which is MyFRT. So what exactly is forensics? The process of identifying, preserving, analysis, presenting and of digital evidence in a manner that is legally acceptable in judicial and administrative hearing. Basically, cyber forensics is a science wherein we are trying to identify the evidences and preservation of all that evidence, plus analyzing the data, trying to identify what all useful information can be gathered from there, and collecting and presenting it so that it's convenient for the investigators and investigators can take charge and have a legal preview of all the cases that are going on. So the process of identifying and preserving, you can say, is like the medium between the law and technology. So what exactly are the principles of cyber forensic examination? The first thing that we have to take into consideration is the data integrity. Make sure that the evidence is free from contamination and full documentation of the whole process, so that there is there's a chain of custody maintained and there is no step left over or a loophole present in the examination. These are the types of digital media that we find in different locations for our imaging purposes and forensic methods that we have to use. Hard disks and hard drives, internal or external, flash drives, CD drives, floppy drives, even though they're discontinued now, there are still places where we've found them. SIM cards and memory cards are found in mobile devices, tape drives, iPods, MP3 players, even though they're specifically used for containing media. A lot of times we even find documents and softwares on these particular players as well. A lot of times we have seen that evidences are masqueraded in two different types of toys or other utilities. Like, we have found pen drives which look like lipsticks or toys of kids, like elephants and all the things that you can see on the screen, lockets and everything. This is a picture of the server room that we had once visited, and trying to find the hard disk in this particular... Hello?
Yes, I can hear.
Yeah. I'm so sorry. It showed up that there's network issue. So so this is a server room that we had once visited, and as you can see, it's very difficult for people to identify where exactly the hard disks are, which particular rack is meant for the storage, and then which particular rack is meant for file. and so forth. So this is one of the...
Now, see, basically, we have seen the do's and don'ts. Now, even it is true for the mobile phone also. Now, which we have not mentioned. Now, in mobile phones, we always suggest that you put, the moment you get the mobile phone, you put it in sharing mode so that nobody else from outside enters and puts the handset in reset mode. And we have seen it practically that, you know, officers or people, they have seized the mobile phone and they have put it into a locker and locked it with a key. But there is network. Okay, person from outside, he logs on to that particular mobile. He says that he lost his phone. So it has all the data. And remember, once the mobile phone goes into a eraser or it goes into a reset mode, there is no method to retrieve any particular data. So that is the secured part. Now, what we should do is, the moment you take the phones, put it in airplane mode. Now, before putting it in airplane mode, collect the passwords. If I say that I can break the password or a PIN code or a pattern lock of a particular mobile, then it is like very few mobile handsets whose pattern lock or PIN code can be broken. But maximum times, we have no idea or we cannot you break those PIN codes. For example, iPhone. There is no method to break the iPhone PIN code, right? Next is we identify the server's hardware architecture, network topology, and identify the point of data entry in the systems. Now, previously we used to have, in this session, I think there will be some of the people from the law enforcement agencies where they might remember, like previously when they used to go on raid, they used to collect all the systems, like in our office, it's like 20 to 30 or 50 systems they have seized. Now, when they have seized so much of systems, we don't know what in which network they were connected. We don't know what was the hardware configuration. Now, in that too, evidence will be present in only few systems. That's why we should try to find out, identify first from where the data entry is done in a particular system. Identify the type of database used. Now, if it fraud is a financial fraud and it's a big, a major firm or a major company is involved in that. And when we seize a particular server, it goes wrong unless and until we take the correct backup of the database, because you have to analyze the database to find out the financial fraud. And if you just bring the server without taking the backup of the database, then the database again cannot be restored onto the forensic system where you will be doing the analysis. One of the challenges we should understand if any customized softwares are used. Now, there are many organizations or companies or firms which have custom made software. Now, for example, there is an organization in which, now if a transaction has happened, a financial transaction which happens in cash, they save it on a different database. If a transaction which has happened using bank or using a check or using a credit card or debit card, a different database is being used. Now, when the law enforcement questions them, they always show the transactions which has happened via the debit card or credit card. The cash transactions, which is present in a different database, that they never show. So when we enter a premise, when you go for a search, we should search for if they are using a customized software. So if they are using a customized software, try to get the manual and understand the working of that particular software. Now, the challenges, as you are seeing, network is the biggest challenge. Right now also we are facing, we have went on to the 4G, but still the voice quality is not better than the 2G. Am I audible?
Yeah, please. Thank you.
So the other challenge is the encryption. This is the biggest challenge. And right now, even there will be some companies which believe like if there is a ransomware attack, everything goes encrypted, right? And there is no method, practically there is no method to retrieve or remove that particular encryption. Even right now, Windows is coming with encryption, right? BitLocker, there are TrueCrypt, encryptions are there. Now, if we bring a system which is encrypted, there is no method to decrypt and get the data unless and until you have the key. The third challenge what we face is data retrievable. Now, data retrieval, there are many people who say that, you know, you have got the hard disk, you are a forensic people, and you should be able to retrieve 100% data. Now, we are forensics people, but we are not magicians. We don't do magic. We don't have a magical wand which will, like, you know, will turn around and the whole data is going to be retrieved. Now, there are challenges like overwritten files, okay? Invalid clusters. Clusters are not getting read, or the hard disk is physically destroyed, right? So there are challenges in retrievable also. The next challenge comes in analyzing. Now, analysis is a part which is very specific to a particular case. Now, if we don't understand the case, we don't know what the IO or the outcome of my analysis should be, okay? Then analysis is like searching for a needle in the haystack. I can do lot of analysis, but you know what is required by the IO? What is the type of fraud which has been done? If we don't come to know in this, then the whole analysis becomes waste. And we are, for analysis, I can say that we sometimes spend around 3 to 4 days or even weeks analyzing one particular hard disk, which is just of 500 GB. Hello? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in between, you can just put something so that, you know, I can understand that you are, I am audible to you all. So another challenge in analysis, I can tell you, like, is we were doing a particular case in Kerala itself, and we were searching lot of document, XLS sheets. It was like a financial fraud. And we were not able to get any data from that particular hard disk. Okay. Now, luckily, what happened in one of the files whose extension was EXE or DLL, we found that the signature is mismatching. And when we saw that, analyzed that particular file, we found that it is an Excel sheet. But the extension, what it is showing, and the place of storage of that particular file, it is in C drive, Windows, and System 32, which is very challenging. Now, luckily, we were able to find out few files which were with changed extensions. Then what we did was we concentrated on all the hard disks with changed extensions. That is, we were doing file signature analysis. Now, when we did that, we were able to find out, and the modus operandi of that particular person was, he used to save all his crucial files, okay, in C drive, Windows System 32, and he used to change the extension to DLL or EXE. Right now, this is the biggest challenge. If a particular analyst is not being told, he will be doing all the analysis, but he will miss some of the part. Right now, what was the current practices? Taking hard copies of data and seizing the same. We have seen people like, you know, I can say in one of the very big bank hacking case. Okay, one of the Asia's biggest bank, which was hacked, and money was transferred. And we were the analyst, because it was in another country, we were sent a particular hard disk. Okay, now, what the IT people had sent it to us was, first of all, they had sent us the copy and paste files. And they wanted us to search which are all the transactions done, okay, or which are all the deleted transactions. Now, if you do a copy and copy paste and give us a hard disk, how come we are able to find out which is the file which is deleted? You have not captured the deleted files itself. Then we said them that, you know, you give us the mirror image of that particular server. Now, the next challenge is, they are saying that, okay, if we do Norton Ghost, or if we give you the backup or ISO image, will that be fine? Now, that is not a forensic image, right? So we explained them that this is a forensic image is bit by bit, and you can use XYZ tools to do this. Now, they are saying that, no, we cannot share complete data of the hard disk. What we can do is, we can send you only the D drive of that particular system. Now, the D drive only consisted of unwanted and personal photographs and documents of that particular person who was using the computer, right? And then we went on to that particular place, and we did the imaging and we did the analysis, in which we were able to show them some of the very crucial files. Again, another challenge is, this is basically with the law enforcement, when they label the systems, if they don't label the systems properly, if they don't mention it, whether it was in network, what was the network, what was it configured to, sometimes it becomes a challenge to find out or to run some of the softwares. Sometimes backups taken, okay, they don't open up at time of analysis. You know, even right now also, there are some of the cases which we have seen, or we go on searches, we have seen only people have a floppy drive. Now, this is a hardware challenge, right? There are no computers right now or desktops right now in which I can insert a floppy disk and get the data. Right? And the last one, which making copies of only the partitions. They say that, you know, D drive is my personal drive, personal partition, so I cannot share my personal data from that particular drive. You take only the C drive. Now, there are challenges when we take only the partitions. The main challenge is, you get only the specific data of that particular partition, nothing else. But what forensics says, according to the principles of forensics, you should have the complete hard disk for doing the analysis. So I'll go to the next slide. Now, what are the shortcomings of some of the current practices? Sometimes we use open source tools. Sometimes some of the tools say they recover the data. The issue becomes data integrity. Now, suppose I want to take a remote of a particular system, and I say them that, you know, you install Zoom on your system, then I will take the remote desktop and I will install my software on that. Now, while doing all those things, when we do this remote part, I am installing applications. By installing these applications, I am losing the data integrity. I am losing the authenticity of that particular system, right? Sometimes people don't use write protection. Write protection means we should not be able to write anything on the suspect's hard disk. Our tools should not leave any imprint on the suspect's hard disk. While doing backups, we miss out important files. What we miss out during backups, some of the backups, they don't go for the physical sectors. Always in forensics, we always and always do physical imaging. That's why, for example, just for your information, I can tell you, like, you know, when you see open a Microsoft Word documents property, you will see that there is mentioned size and size on disk. Now, if you try to find out why it is different, size and size of on disk, always the size on disk will be bigger than the normal size. Why so? So the answer is, size is actually the logical size of that particular file, whereas size on disk is actually the number of sectors it is taking inside that particular hard disk, right? So when you take backup, you don't do actually a physical backup. You do a logical backup. Then no proper chain of custody is maintained. Yes, this is the most important part, that is the chain of custody. See, chain of custody always tells that who had taken the custody of the laptop, and when he has taken the custody, what has happened? What is the chain? Like, after Yogendra has taken the custody of the laptop, he has sent the laptop to Dhenuka. Then what did Dhenuka did? Mirror imaging was done. For what purpose it was done? Okay. Then what was the image? What was the hash value of that particular image? This should be properly maintained in the chain of custody form. Next, gathering data. Now, importance of standard procedure is we are gathering the data in a forensically sound manner. We are caring that the digital media is not damaged. We are not trying to put any data on the suspect's machine so that any particular data is getting overwritten, or we are not able to manipulate any of the data, right? So a particular tool, any tool which you use for a forensic analysis, you know, it should not allow, the forensic software should not allow the examiner to overwrite anything. The forensic tool should not allow the examiner to manipulate any particular data. Same thing in the chain of custody. No data has been added, changed, or deleted from the seized information evidence. The seized information evidence was duplicated exactly and completely. A reliable and validated duplication process was used, and all media were secure. Now, even we have seen cases wherein a particular laptop was seized. Now, in the seizure memo, they had mentioned a laptop, Dell and Inspiron model number, serial number has been seized. Now, at the time of analysis, we opened the laptop. We found that the data is present of someone else. Now, the mistake what they had done was they had not mentioned the model number, serial number of the storage media, that is the hard disk. So because of that, someone might change the hard disk. Keeping the same laptop, they have changed the hard disk. Everything okay?
Yeah, please carry on. Okay.
Yeah, so now there are also situations in which like a laptop has been seized. When you bring it for analyze, there is no hard disk. So at the time of seizure, one should mention the model number, serial number of the desktop or the laptop. Also, they should mention the model number, serial number, and storage of the hard disk which is inside, right? Then a reliable and validated duplication process should be used. Now in this, what we mean to, there are a lot of open source tools which do validation of making a duplication or making a mirror image of a hard disk. But few of them, there are some of the insights or some settings needs to be done. Now we have found in some places, like some 30 to 40 hard disks were seized. Okay, the mirror image was given to us and none of the mirror image is opening. Okay, so we tried to find out. So we found out that there was a particular setting in that particular open source which was to be done. And that particular person who was taking that image, he didn't do that setting. And because of that, the whole image is corrupted. Nobody is able to, or we are not able to view the content of those images. We go to the next slide. Now, fundamental procedure. Wherever, whenever you are going for a digital forensics, these things you should keep in mind. Write blocking should be there. You should always work on duplicate copy. That is the image copy, not on the original hard disk. And whichever files you export, whichever image you have taken, always make sure you calculate the hash value and always match whether at the time of imaging the hash value was same or not. If at the time of making a mirror image, the hash value is not matching or it has been calculated, and at the time of analysis, hash value is not matching, means somebody has done something wrong in that particular image. Now, what are the steps? Now, collect all the digital evidences. It should be either original or always on the image. Separate main copies and the working copies. Working copies are like on which the examiner will do the analysis. Main copies are basically the original hard disks or the one copy of the image which is kept in safe, right? Now, pack all the working copies in a separate box. Signature on the COC form should be taken. Otherwise, suppose you have come to my place and you have taken my hard disk image and I have not signed on the chain of custody form. So tomorrow I can always say that this particular hard disk does not belong to me. Right? So take all the legal part. COC comes as a legal part which in which the particular person whose system is being imaged, he should sign that this particular system is my image, my system, and his image has been taken. Now, when we are seizing a server, it should be wrapped with anti-static tape, bubble wrap, and it should be sealed in a manner that no one can start it or open that particular digital evidence. Now, when we are seizing a server, basically, we always suggest that don't seize the server. Try to go for real-time imaging by keeping the server on. Now, there are instances wherein we have spent around 15 to 20 days just imaging a particular server. Okay, and that too, you can see the irony here. We have to just start the system once. All other 14 days, you have to just come and watch the screen, what is happening on the screen, that is mirror imaging. That's all, right? Go to the next. Now, this is the acquisition, making an image, right? So we take the logical backup and I have shown you the physical image. Then what all the issues? Now, a particular image, imaging a 500 GB hard disk, as I told you earlier, takes around 3 to 4 hours. Now, 10 years back, imaging a 80 GB hard disk used to take 3 to 4 hours. So because of the new technology, new methodology which has come up, now 80 GB hard disk, we can finish it in half an hour. But now the storage has increased, 500 GB, 1 TB, 2 terabytes, and the time increases. Now, these are some of the methods which is, you know, for making a mirror image. Now, here only in the end, I will be showing you how the imaging process actually for the law enforcement agencies and for the corporates, the method of imaging cannot be automated. We cannot automate this. Someone has to be there on that particular place and he has to do this type of imaging because there are n number of challenges when we go for the image. Sometimes USB does not work. Sometimes you don't have the connectors. Sometimes there is a power problem. Sometimes you have to use only the network methodology. Sometimes the network is disabled. Sometimes it is encrypted. So we have to follow different methodology during the imaging time. Next. Now here what we have shown is a write block. Okay. So always the suspect machine should be, or suspect's hard disk should be connected with a write blocker. Now, this is one of the methodology in which we are using a hardware which does the duplication process. Same way, another hardware which does the duplication or the mirror imaging process. Now, comes the analysis part. In the analysis, there are three steps. We have to extract, that is, you know, recover the file, carve the file, then you should process it so that you can read it. And then comes the third part, interpret. Now, interpret, you have to say it. Okay, being a forensic examiner, you have to give an opinion whether this particular file has been downloaded or whether this particular file has been altered, modified, whatever it is. So it requires interpretation. Now, if, for example, I can say that if you download a particular file, it goes and gets saved into a folder of downloads. Now, it is not necessary that download folder will always contain the files which have come from the internet or downloaded files. I can also copy and paste a particular file in a download folder. Nothing wrong in that, right? My interpretation should be like I should be able to prove and I should be able to show some evidences that show that this particular file has been downloaded from the internet, right? Let's go. Now, another method, time analysis, in this analysis is the challenge is operating systems, different operating systems. Right now, if a Windows system comes, maximum of the examiners are very happy. They have got all the tools and all which will work. The moment it comes for a different operating system like Mac OS, then it becomes a challenge. So not right now, the latest Mac OS, which is there, it is like only few tools support the that type of operating system. Other forensic softwares, they don't support it. You have to use different methodology to bring out data from those operating systems. Different data hiding techniques are there, which one of the case study I have just told you, ghosting methods, changing the file extensions, changing the file attribute, storing in operating system files. Then comes the application softwares. Now, maximum of the financial frauds which we have seen is by the softwares, and those softwares are developed in-house. Now, you can know, you know, for application softwares, suppose you get an extension of YOG, okay? Now, if you Google it also, you will not get any such extension, any such, you know, proper report that this YOG extension is present and for what file it is present and all. Now, that's where what we say is when you go for such type of raids, you should try to identify if any applications are there which you don't know. If you don't know, try to ask the assessee, or you can ask the custodian of that particular system, okay? That which is this application, what for what purpose you have this particular application, and from where have you got this application, who has developed this application, all those things. Then another challenge, regional language fonts. Now, if I am sitting in Delhi and a particular hard disk has been couriered to me from Kerala, or for that sake from Tamil Nadu, and that particular person has used a font of suppose Malayalam font or a Tamil font, for me in the beginning it will be all junk characters, unless and until I try to find out which is the word format and which all the fonts being used on that particular system. Then I configure my examiner's system with that particular fonts, and then I view those type of regional languages, right? Now, the onion model method, this is the analysis. It's just like you can go on peeling the onion and the evidence will be inside. The more deeper you go, more evidences you can collect. So there are operating system, files, then content, then total outside will be the physical media, right? Now, this is the where all your evidence will be present. Now, what is an evidence? Evidence only will be one particular file, which is very important, which is having key transactions, which you are searching. Okay, now you have searched or you have brought more than 20-30 systems, but you want what? Only one user file which contains transactions or which shows that the fraud has happened in this particular method, a particular log which shows that a hacking has happened, right? So when we search the evidence, it can be an active file, it can be deleted file from the file's metadata, from some software applications. It can be a hidden file, it can be encrypted file, it can be a partition which is hidden, it can be a swap file, it can be a keyword search, right? Now, just going to the registry of a particular system is a very key part of a particular Windows system. It keeps the configuration of a system, information about the user activity, about the applications which are installed, which are opened, how many times the particular file has been opened, Windows position and size, information about the timestamp, when the particular system was on, when the particular system was off. So registry analysis is one full field in which you have to analyze it deeply for getting the timestamp about the user activity, about the configuration of the systems and whatnot, right? Next, these are all the registry. So what all information you can get from the registry, that is the computer name, any dynamic days, call days, last user logged in, which are all the devices which are mounted, Windows operating systems, product key, who is the registered owner, which all the programs which run automatically, are there any USBs connected to the system, and if which are all those USBs. For this, I can just give you one of a case study. Like a particular system was there, a laptop was said to be analyzed, and the case was like we had to prove that a particular person is using this laptop. The laptop is a property of a company. The laptop is using the network of the company, and this particular person is downloading some unwanted pictures and videos on the system using the company's bandwidth, right? So in this, we were able to prove that the Windows operating system is registered in the name of that particular company. Windows Microsoft Office is registered. The IP address which was used to download such videos and photographs is showing of that particular company. And that's how the report comes. And we give the opinion saying that the particular person's laptop, Windows operating system is registered in name of this. Microsoft Office is registered in the name of the company. The IP address which has been used to download this particular photographs and videos is showing of the company. Okay, that's how it proves that particular person is using the company's resources to download personal photographs and videos. Same way, USB devices. Now, if there is a data leakage case, always data you can leak from a particular system or you can copy it from a particular system is like from the internet, if from the USB, or you can memorize that particular data. Now, data is humongous. Memorizing it is not easy. So you have to send it via internet or using a USB. So if I see the list of the USBs which are connected to the particular system, I will be able to show which are all the USBs connected and which are all the files which have been or which may have been copied on the USB devices. Okay, so we just move to the next part. This is just showing the USBs, which are all the USBs connected. So tools for doing the registry analysis. These are some of the tools which are used: regedit, reg, autorun, scripting. Then we go to the next. Automation, where all main part, where all we can do the automation of processing. Now, that is comes in examination and analysis. When you analyze it, there are few things which we need to do on each of the hard disk or each of the systems. Like first thing we should do is hash. Create a hash value, create a hash of all the files. Then we should do is file signature analysis. We should do the signature analysis of all the systems, all the files, which will tell us which file is, whose extension has been changed or renamed and all. Then comes data retrieval part. So, and once data retrieval is done, then you can create two folders, which files are present, which files are deleted, and which files are user files. Like you will be interested in the files which have been created by users, like doc files, Excel files, PDF files. Okay. Now, if these files are present, these are user files, mail files, user files, then I can segregate system files. Now, there will be another case where we have to analyze only the system files. There will be cases wherein we have to analyze only the user files, right? So if I can automate this process of the first four steps, then my work gets a lot easier. So it's just like, I have got a ready-made system, and then whose hashing has been done, signature analysis has been done, and data retrievable has been done. Two folders have been created. Now I have to just work which are all the important files. Then I can run a keyword search and get my data, right? So I'll just do the demonstration of that. And right now the remote acquisition need of the hour, as you all seeing, we are all working from home, and we always get a call saying that during this time, if you are able to, you know, mirror image a particular system and get out of it. Yeah, anyone? Hello?
Yeah, yeah, it's okay. Please go ahead. Oh.
So what we have done is we have developed a particular application which needs to be installed. Now, installed on the remote system means it's an agent which has to be sent on that particular system. You can send it using Active Directory method, or you can download it and send it. Any method you can use it. That particular application is just in KBs, kilobytes, such a small application. Okay. Now, why I say such a small application? Because now I don't want to install a big application like TeamViewer or Abby, in which it takes largest space to get installed, and when it consumes larger space, data chances of overwriting the data is more. That's why I am taking a particular agent which will be of KBs. Even if it is trying to do overwriting, it will be overwriting only KBs of particular data. Okay, now because we have no other option just to do remote, we have to follow this particular procedure. Now, let me just give you the demonstration of a particular tool in which we have automated it. Now, this is a particular tool which I'm using it. Are you able to see?
Yes, we can.
Yeah? Okay.
Yes. So,
the tool which we have created, in which we create a case, you can open a particular case. Okay, so in create a case, add device, you can add folders, you can add a drive, you can add evidences. Now in this we have got tools which is doing write blocking. Okay, now with this particular tool, I have taken first care that my suspect's hard disk, suspect's machine is always write blocked. Okay. Now, I open a particular case. I have created one particular case. Right? This is a particular case which I had created. It consists of a complete hard disk of around 1 terabyte of size. Now, if you see on the home screen, what we have done is add evidence, add device, add folder, add remote. Okay. Now, if I want to take a remote image, I click on add remote, and my this particular server or this particular application searches for the agent which has been placed on a particular IP address. Okay, once it takes the agent, what it will do is it will download all the user files. Okay, or if you want to take an image, now doing an image on the network is not a big thing unless and until you have got such a good bandwidth and such a good speed. Now, this is theoretical. In practical situations, we have even seen imaging just an 80 GB of hard disk on the network, and it was having a speed of around 8 or download speed of 8 Mbps. you know, it was showing around 13 months to just make a mirror image of a particular hard disk. Okay. So rather than that, I will wait for this COVID period to finish. I will go physically and take a mirror image of that particular hard disk. So taking a remote part is always like you should decide first, what do you want to take? If possible, what we always suggest on the remote is you connect an external hard disk to the suspect's machine. The agent will do a mirror image there itself, and then you can send that particular hard disk, okay, for further analysis. Now, in evidence, suppose I have added my evidence file. My evidence file, you can see here, is this. It is ICFSA test, which shows zero. It consists of the partitions C drive, D drive, E drive, and F drive. These are the deleted files. Here the recovered files will be shown. Here the carved files will be shown. Okay. Now, what we have done is, the moment I add a particular hard disk, I automate it. How I automate it is the automated process. What I want to do, I want the present files to be processed, deleted files to be processed, and recovered files to be processed. If I want, I can give the time period where I want to put the folder, where I want to store my report, and I want to create a hash. You know, this particular tool is designed by keeping law enforcement agencies in mind. Like, they have to do minimum clicks and they will be able to get the data. Okay. So present files, deleted files, recovered with time period. If you want, you can do the time period. You can download this particular file in report. You can create a hash and you can say, default filters are there. You can create your own filters, add tally filters, picture filters, media filters, registries. And once you have done, you have to just say start. Now, this is about the files. Let us go with the filters. I can create new filter of my own, add new. I can give my own extensions, whichever I want. And it will process only with those type of extensions, right? Now, artifacts. What is the operating system information, USB info, user info, which are all the link files present? What is the browsing history of the particular browsers? What are the software information, application access? So once this particular process has been done, okay, now where I can see the result, I can go in deleted, I can click here, I can file the files, I can click here so that I will be able to get the data. So it will just take the data. So till the time the data populates, we'll show you the artifacts part. Now you can see here the artifacts which we have found out. It shows that the product is Windows 10. What is the product ID? Which version it is? Who is the registered owner? It is blank. Registered organization. When this particular system was installed? When was this system last shut down? Okay. Now I'll just add a few things in this. Last shutdown means when I go properly shutting down a particular system, I follow the proper shutdown system. Now, if a particular system is on and I remove the power supply, it is not shut down. It will not show the date as a proper shutdown, right? Next is USB information. Now, see which are all the USBs which has been connected on this particular system. What is their friendly name? which is the vendor, what is the product, what is the serial number of this particular pen drive, and when it was last connected, and what was the mapped drive, okay? Which drive? Sometimes it is F drive. Somebody had given a name of such a thing, okay? Now, what was the user information? Who are all were the users? Sandy is there, one user. Sandeep is there. Big Admin is there. These are the three users. Other three users are the by default users. Link file analysis. It shows which are all the files whose link is created. This helps, this analysis helps in finding out files which have been transferred or which has been accessed from a different location. Then comes browsing history. Then it is showing Chrome and Internet Explorer. Softwares, which are all the softwares which has been installed, which has been uninstalled. Then comes the application access. Which are all the applications? You can see here, user Sandy, he has used Windows Immersive Control Panel. When? 2018. How many times he has used? 5 times. The particular person is installed Flash Player. Windows Explorer he has used 26 times. Then Windows Feedback Hub 14 times has been accessed on that particular date. So all these details you can see. Now, let me just go back to my evidence, then filters. Now, these are my filters, okay? Present filters. How many Word files are there? How many Excel files are there? How many Adobe files are there? How many compressed files are there? Okay, now comes deleted. Same way, how much deleted files are there? Word, Excel, Adobe, compressed. How much we have recovered? How much we have carved, okay? Based on this, now, if you see this, this particular process, it took me only few hours, like 2 to 3 hours, I am ready with such data. Now, apart from this, now comes the another part. I can do a keyword search on this particular data and get my results. I can do index of this particular files and get my results. And that's where we say that we are able to analyze a particular hard disk using such tools within a day. Within 1 day, we are able to analyze 1 terabyte of a hard disk. Right? So this is all with me, and thank you all for hearing me.
Vigata, hello.
Yes.
Vigata, Adira will be taking over the moderator post. Okay. She will be handling. Adira, please.
Hello.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Yogendra Yadav, for your wonderful session. I now request Mr. Vishwas Gopinath to conclude the session for us so that we can go to the Q&A session. So.
Thank you, Adira. I think we had a very wonderful session on automation part. I think we got a very clear picture in a distinct manner, a very simple manner, that how things can be automated and we can reduce time. Recovery process, and also we can to some extent we can use those manpower into expertise their skills and minimum things. So I think thank you very much, Yogendra, for your wonderful session. I think we
thank you, sir.
We all had a clear cut picture of how things can be automated. I think we are getting a lot of questions. In fact, I don't know if we can go back, revisit the entire questions. I think we can answer some of them because we have got 15 minutes more. I think, okay, yeah. Adira?
Yes, sir, sure. We can just go through the chat box for the questions. We can just answer a few of them that you feel is important.
Yogendra, can you see the questions?
I'm just trying.
So there is a chat icon near. So
yeah, just seeing that. Yeah, there is a question from Mr. Test Kumar saying that is it good idea to temporary root Android phone to acquire data? See, basically all the forensic tools, basically if you want to do a physical image of a mobile Android phone, you have to root it, okay? But nowadays, all the latest handsets which are coming, okay, and I can even say Android 8 onwards, you cannot root the handsets. So it was true only for Androids which were having Android 7 and below, which you can root and then you can acquire. But nowadays, latest handsets, you are not able to root it. If you can root, doing a physical image is the best. You can get all those data. So another question is from Mr. Abhishek Doshi. Will the categorized file be examined and indexed based on signatures? If we use MyFRT, NK sometimes misses out such files, but FTK indexing is powerful in such cases. Now, first thing is indexing, and second thing is signatures. Now, indexing is when you want to do a keyword search, and FTK was made previously was a company for breaking passwords. And you know, in passwords, if you have a good dictionary, then you can break the passwords. So FTK does indexing very good, no doubt about it. But when you say signature analysis, signature is matching the header information with the extension of that particular file. Now, all the tools have this capability of doing the signature analysis, that is matching the header information of a file and based on the extension of that particular file. What Encase also does the same. Now, what it does is it matches in its, it has got already a configuration file from where it matches the header and it matches with the extension. Same way MyFRT also does and FTK also does. Sir, can a single case handled by two or more experts? Right now, no. A single case can be done by only one person. Okay, if it is open at one particular place. You have multiple copies, then you can use it. Next question is by Mr. Nilesh. Sir, does this automation tool support Mac OS? Right now, no. This particular tool works for Windows operating system. Yeah, there's a very good question. Jayant Gambhir has asked, the last access date of a system file is later than Windows shutdown date. Now, as I had explained you earlier, Mr. Jayant, it is like when you shut down a system, when you do proper shutdown, you go in start, you press shutdown, and then it will ask for restart, shutdown and all, and then you press shutdown, then it will be logged as a proper shutdown date. Then the registry will mark this particular date. But if you abruptly pull the power down or you remove the power supply directly, then it doesn't get recorded in the registry. And because of this reason, the last access date of a system file may come later and the shutdown date can come earlier. Right? So Ms. Jaya Jotmani, very nice session. If there can be sessions on hand on using these tools, yes, we can try for running on hands-on sessions. Is there a difference in write blocked and write protected? Yes, there is a difference. when you do it from the registry and when it is a temporary, it is write block. When you do it permanently using a hardware, it is write protected. Sir, how to ensure proper? See, basically a chain of custody should take care of starting of an incident. Like you have started, you have entered a particular place or a particular suspect's machine has been handed over to you. And till the time the report has been prepared, it should keep a track of each and everything. That is what a proper chain of custody means. So, does this tool support macOS? No. So, a copied evidence be altered by the scientist, and if yes, then the accused lawyer can go against it and claim that the evidence has been manipulated. Yes, very much if he proves that the copied evidence file has been altered. Now, first of all, we should understand an evidence file. As you had seen in my example, if it is an E01 file or an evidence file format or expert witness format, EWF format or EFF format or a proprietary format, okay? Now, what the tools do, basically, if you ask me, like in case what they do is, it checks the checksum MD5 hash, and so if any alteration is there in the evidence file, the hash value will not match. If that hash value does not match, it will not have, authentication. So if there it is not authentic, then quite obvious that a particular evidence has been manipulated and the accused can go to the accused lawyer can win the case. Which software you prefer for making clone of hard disk? I prefer Encase, I prefer FTK, I prefer MyFRT. So next question. There was an objection by accused that a file was planted in hard disk by IO and it was not present while seizing. How to prove that it was done? See, basically it can come via the date and time of that particular file. You have to match that. So yes, Mr. Test Kumar has asked a question that challenges in data acquisition of SSD. See, there is no challenge in acquisition of an SSD. The challenge in SSD hard disk is basically recovery of data. And in SSDs, it has got a trim facility which overwrites the data. And because of that, you won't be able to retrieve any data. And that's the reason in SSD hard disk. And basically most of the SSDs are in Apple, but now it comes in basically all the hard laptops. In SSD hard disk, data recovery is very, very, very less. I think I have answered much of them. Difference between disk clone and disk image. Yes. Basically, when I say clone, means the hard disk will boot and you will be able to see the content as of the normal hard disk. Whereas when I say disk image, it all the content, all the physical content of a particular hard disk will be stored as a file. The file can be in the extension of E01 or AD1 or any, like basically the forensic tools extension, like Encase makes an image in E01 format. So in foreign disk image, you cannot see the content of that particular file unless and until you are using a forensic tool. Whereas in disk clone, you can see the content of that particular file. And there are many differences between disk clone and disk image. Basically, if on my system, I am an examiner and I'm connecting a clone to my system. If on the clone, it is a virus, that virus will start acting on my system also, right? So that's the reason that all the differences between a disk phone and disk. Okay.
I think we have answered almost all the questions.
Yeah, there are many.
Almost. Thank you. Thank you very much. Any more questions? No.
There is a.
Yeah. Sir, we have 5 more minutes. If you have any questions to clarify, you can.
There is a question by Ritam, Pritam. What problems you face during data recovery of damaged storage devices? Is it possible to recover? If yes, percentage. See, it is possible to recover data from a damaged hard disk, but you should one should try to find out the percentage of damage and what is the damage which has happened. Okay. If you are able to find out what is the damage which has happened, like physical damage, if physical, are the ICs or the motherboard of that particular hard disk proper, intact? Is it possible to recover? Yes, there is possibility of recovery. And as I said, there is no fixed percentage of recovery in data which has been lost. I can say sometimes we can recover all the files, we can recover only some few readable files. Sometimes it is everything is corrupt, everything is junk characters, so none. Another question is from Neha. Sir, my question is, what's the procedure to become a cyber expert in forensics after completing BSc and MSc in forensic science? Is it compulsory to have computers subject in BSc? Basically, yes, if you have BSc computers, it will always add on. And MSc in forensics, there are a lot of universities which are providing this various courses and even engineering in cyber forensics itself. So another question is from Dhyanesh, saying that elaborate what is a hash value. Hash value is nothing but a 26 character alphanumeric value which proves that a particular file has not been altered. It shows authenticity of a particular file. Okay. So if there is a file, you have calculated the MD5, then you have given it to someone else. If the file is same and same authentic file which you had sent, the hash value will match. If the hash value does not matches, means that particular person has done some changes in it. How to overcome covert channel as it is less identifiable? What do you mean by covert channel? Is Mr. Raju there? What he means by covert channel?
Mr. Raju, you can reply.
So I think I've completed the maximum of the questions. If you have any other questions, you can send me on my mail. My mail ID is there.
Yeah,
I think
that's fine.
Now, Sir Raju, here.
Yeah, yes, sir. What do you want to say by covert channel? Like on the hard disk? See, basically, if it is on a hard disk.
Yeah, like in hard disk.
Yeah, so we will be able to find out, yes.
Okay. Okay, sir. Because...
So I think we can wind it up because we are running out of time now. So others, the participants, you can mail your queries to Mr. Yogendra Yadav. So thank you so much, sir, for your time and knowledge shared here. And thank you, Vikas sir, for presiding this session and all the participants for your active participation. And with your permission, I now